Hello, everyone. This is Cynthia Mazzaferro with Powerful Beyond Measure, and I am so excited to have another fabulous author with another fabulous book. His name is Vincent Puglisi. Did I say that right, Vincent?
Puglisi, close. Everybody gets it.
Puglisi. What's the nationality on
it's
that?
Italian. It's Italian.
It is. I see. My husband's Italian. Now, my name is Mazzaferro.
So
I don't say it quite as well.
You have the O at the end. The E messes everybody up.
Oh, well, good. I feel a little better.
No, that's the number one question. People go, okay, how do I pronounce your name? Like since I was a kid. So,
well, very good. So, Vincent, I'd love for you to just share a little bit about yourself, your background, and then we can get into your wonderful book, which is Freelance to Freedom, which is just wonderful.
Thank you. Yeah, I am married 15 and a half years to my beautiful wife, Elizabeth. We have three boys. We homeschool the last 3 years. They're 12, 10, and 6. We live in Pittsburgh. I've been a professional photographer for about 23 years. But more recently, I've moved into this whole book, which was new to me. Like, I am not an author. You know, I'm not a writer. Like, this is all crazy. I do a whole lot of the Freelance to Freedom is basically like our life of going from employees to being heavily in debt and this life of that we didn't want, that we were very frustrated making. You know, $15 an hour with a baby on the way and a lot of debt to starting a side business to where we use that to leverage ourselves to pay off all of our debt, clear up our time, quit our jobs, gain a life of freedom. We've been doing that for 10 years now. And about 6 or 7 years ago, I kept getting the same questions. How did you do this? How did you do this? And I'm like, I didn't think there was anything really too much about it, anything special, but we kept having so many inquiries about it that I decided, you know, I'm going to write this book, but I kind of dragged my feet. I think like a lot of us do. And finally we were on vacation and my wife said to me, she goes, I'm going to take the kids to the beach. You're going to go to the coffee shop and start writing your book. I'm tired of hearing you talk about it. So
okay. Before you get there, Vincent, I want to back up a little bit. So I was really looking for, you know, what were you doing before you wrote the book as an author? So you are a professional photographer and I saw in the book, I mean, you have been in most of all of the major stadiums and almost every athletic sport there is. I mean, just go ahead and toot your horn. What were some of the sports that you actually photographed?
I've shot them all. I'm on a quest to photograph in every stadium in the country. Every stadium. So I've shot about 140 different stadiums and arenas around the U.S. I've shot Super Bowl, World Series. I shot the NHL final this year. First time in 23 years. I've shot, you know, the no hitters around like at Yankee Stadium. We've got the photograph, you know, Muhammad Ali's 70th birthday. You know, Tom Brady, Michael Jordan, pretty much anybody you could imagine that I would be old enough to photograph, I've been able to do, which is pretty remarkable just being a sports fan as a kid to then going on the sidelines and photographing it. So we did that. My wife and I both are wedding and corporate commercial photographers. That really is what made the money. The sports doesn't. Sports is really cool, but it's not very profitable. So,
okay, well, you're actually getting ahead of ourselves. So let's not tell everyone what you're getting into. You're jumping way up there in front. So let's slow it down because we gotta get the reader here and the watcher here, the viewer, to understand what it is that actually caused you to go ahead and get out into freelance and use your passion and create this financial as well as time freedom that really has impacted your life in so many ways. And all for the good, which is really great. Kudos to you. And that's really what his book's about, you know. So let's start with, as you in your book do, start with the beginning, how your family had their own, you know, business that was doing well, and then the economy hit and things didn't go so well. And how your father kind of, you describe him in the book, sitting on the couch and kind of in this contemplative stupor state of not knowing what to do.
Yeah.
How did that really impact you personally?
It tremendously. What happened was my dad, he had a partnership. You know, it really scarred me to partnerships. His partner emptied the bank accounts. $135,000 overnight, moved to a different state. And, you know, he was a draftsman. They were in construction and literally no money. And then all these jobs were unfinished. He's on the news. There's lawsuits. I'm 16 years old. You know, you don't usually, I didn't get along with my parents at 16. You know, we had a, you know, you're 16 and you add that on top of it. I mean, I ran away from home a couple of times. It really impacted the way that I looked at money. I became a lot more just aware of it. My brother was a little bit older and he kind of didn't see it. And it really shaped my mind in terms of like how important it is to control your money. to be in control of it and your time and how other people can affect what you do. So I think that's really helped shape where we're at today.
Yeah, it did. And but you also struggled, you and your wife. And even though you realized money was really important and to not overspend, you actually found that you were in a place that you had overspent.
Yeah, we became normal, as they say. You know, I, you know, my 20s, even though I didn't make very much money, I wasn't going into debt at all. So I really kind of had freedom while I was building my freelance life. I went back to school, to college. That's where I met my awesome wife. But the problem was we both got jobs at newspapers. So we're now full-time employees. And we buy a house. And all of a sudden, we crept into what everybody else was doing, which I didn't want to do before. But I bought into it. We bought the house. We had the car payments. We had the student loans. We had the credit card bills for the furniture that we bought around the house, all those things. And all of a sudden, we have a baby on the way, and we're $140,000 in debt. And my wife wants to be home with our son. And I'm not making that much money. And like life's just like a 2x4, like over the side of the head, like this is not working. And it hit me. So that was a big point.
Yeah, it was. And, you know, I think as the bread provider or the man of the house, typically, you know, you're realizing that once you start to bring a child into the world, it's not just about you and your wife and not maybe having the, you know, all the plush dinners and going out for this and that, we can scrimp, but having a child is a whole different thing, and it impacts your, you know, you're not just a husband, wife, now you're parents, you're responsible for someone else.
Absolutely. And the thing is, like, I went from being, you know, single, where it's all about me, and then we get married because there's two of us, and then we have a baby, and it's like, it's not about me anymore at all. And
yeah. And this brings up really a great point, which I know I interviewed someone else earlier, is we don't teach people how to be financial secure before they even get it out of high school. You know, we should be teaching our youth how to save, how to, you know, when you go into work at McDonald's, let's say, you know, that half of your income should go into a savings account. You know, you don't just spend what you make. And unfortunately, not all the parents teach their children that. And so often that they end up getting in the same situation that you and your book does, and that we spend more than we're earning. And it causes such emotional stress within the marriage. And that's why so many divorces are occurring in today's world, because whether you've been married 35 years, financial stress is one of the main reasons that people get divorced.
Yeah, from the studies, it's the number one reason for divorce is financial issues.
It really is. So I think it's great that your wife and you were able to get together. Now, I know there was a radio show and a book that you were listening to that really was kind of the precipice that got you to turn the light on and say, I got to have a shift here. So why don't you talk about that?
Yeah, a lot of people know his name probably now, but when Dave Ramsey, he had this radio show. It wasn't huge. And I found it on some, you know, radio station while I was driving in Illinois on an assignment. And I kept hearing this stuff. And, you know, I was one of those guys, I was in the sports and music, right? That's what I watched on TV, listening on the radio. And I hear this financial show, and which should be boring to me, but I was so intrigued by it because it was like the relationships and what it does to your health and your mind and your... So I'm listening and listening. And then finally I realized this guy, Dave Ramsey, so I keep following him. And I listened to him, but I didn't do it. Right, I thought, you know, I nodded along while these people made these mistakes, but I was doing the same thing, and I'm kind of like, yeah, you shouldn't do that. And I'm like, doing the same exact thing. And it wasn't until we bought his book, we're on vacation, ironically, on credit cards, and I bought his book, and we're on the plane home, and I said to Elizabeth, I said, we have to get out of debt, like, because we wanted to start a family. She wasn't pregnant yet, but you know, 6 months later, she would be. We knew we wanted to start a family, and she thought I was crazy. She's like, because we got so used to the normal lifestyle. And so I said, so I was the driver of it. I really wanted to do it. It took a while to get her on board. And I think like a lot of relationships, if people want to do this, one person wants it more than the other, not both. And that's the question I get more than anything. How do you get your spouse on board when you want to do it? I run mastermind groups and I have a lot of guys in there. And, you know, people talk about men and aloofness, but these guys, they want to do it. And they have spouses that are reluctant. So how do you get, because once we got on board, once she said yes, it was smooth sailing for the most part.
And you're right. You have to have a collective force, because if you're saying we're not going to go out to dinners, we're not going to go out to movies, we're going to the next 2 years be more of hermits and stay homebound to really save, to build up this nest egg, you know, you both have to commit to that. It means she can't go out buying this and that, you know. So it's important for you to both be in that same mindset, which I agree with you, is to make it effective.
Yeah, because if you don't do that, somebody's going to be resentful.
Exactly. Yes, for sure.
So when you get on the same page, and kind of what we realized, which was really the most important part, was it wasn't that bad.
Right.
It wasn't that bad.
You know, and people don't realize how much they really just kind of piss away the money. I can't tell you how many people say, I don't have any money. And I say, oh, tell me what you do during the week. And they go out to eat 4, 5, 6 times. Well, right. That's $25, $30 per meal. All of a sudden, you have $150 per week that you mm-hmm. spend no money on. Yeah. So, I mean, that's just an example. I know I hear so much of people say, I don't have any money. I live on Social Security, you know, and I understand things can be tight, but I also understand that there's a lot of waste, and a lot of people will like feed their cats more than they'll feed themselves.
Yeah. You know?
So the priority of where you're putting your money is also a self-chosen direction. And I think for you to want, and I think that what's powerful about your book is, you know, whether you're going to freelance or not, you know, starting your own business or not, what I think everyone can walk away from in this book is being financially responsible to live within your means, make really great decisions, and hopefully not get in the situation where you're having $150,000 debt to have to climb out of. You know, to use this book as more of a preemptive tool to say, I don't want to get here. I don't want to hit bottom and have to claw myself back out, because it's tough. It's not easy.
It's not easy. And then it's funny. I think Will Smith said, he goes, the best way to get in shape is to stay in shape.
Yeah, I like
right?
that.
And it's the same thing with money. If you don't get into $100,000 of student loans and massive car payments, it's pretty easy. So once we got out of debt, it was like we could, that's the whole where the freelance and the entrepreneur thing came in. It was like, we had such an advantage over everybody else because we could charge the rates we wanted to charge. We didn't worry about losing the jobs, right? We worked with who we wanted to work with, and we got to turn down who we didn't want to work with. And that's what happens is when you become financially secure, it's so much easier to become more successful financially because you don't have all the hurdles holding you back, like having to take a job to pay for that car payment. We didn't have that. So I don't think people even see it. And that's what I wanted to bring out with this book, like what can happen if you do this? Because like you know, like the beginning is the hardest, right? That's the hardest part, is when you're doing this in the beginning, the struggle. But when you can get through that and you see what the benefit is, then all of a sudden people ask you for advice and then you can write a book about it.
But also what really happened too is that, you know, you and your wife were both employed at a newspaper and you were doing these photo shoots and very time intensive, involved traveling to all the different venues and things. So it was very good job. It wasn't a great job. It didn't pay a lot of money, but it was steady income. And that's great. But was it really your passion? And I loved it in the book where it talked about your father was saying, you know, do what you love. And you loved photography. You always did. And but that doesn't mean you have to do the typical job of going out and working for someone else. And what I counsel my clients with too, my coaching clients, is never give up your full-time job. And start to nourish your freelance passion, if you will, or whatever you want to build as a business, because your current job is your vehicle to get you to where you want to go. And you were so good about that in your book. You know, you gave eventually a date that you were actually going to use as a benchmark, and yeah. that you realized that you had met your clearing of debt, and that was a good enough time for you to then say, I'm quitting and I'm starting off on my own. And you can also build that other freelance before you actually start that date. So it's kind of a waxing and waning. You build up the new freelance business as you're eventually going to wane away from the current job that you actually were having.
Absolutely. I'm sure you go through this with your clients. Like we say it all the time, like build it before you need it. And that's the hardest thing, is people don't want to build. You'll notice, like people like, I'm desperate. I need this. And like, I got asked this question on a podcast. Like, if you need to get a $1,500 job by next week, what would you do? And I would say, I'd find a way to get the money, but more importantly, I'd figure out a way to never be in that situation again.
Because why do you need $1,500?
It was a hypothetical. Yeah, exactly. Why that? But even still, it's like, the problem is that you're in that situation to begin with. And it's not the money's not going to solve it, because if you haven't figured out what the problem is, you're just going to be in that situation again next month.
Right? Well, and there's so many reasons for that problem, and I know your book doesn't really revolve around that, but you know, people don't believe in themselves. They figure my parents were like this, so I'm expected to be like this. I'm not educated. I don't have the finances to start a new business. There's so many reasons. We can come up with thousands of reasons and why we can't succeed, why we shouldn't put ourselves out there, take that leap of faith. And all of that is malarkey. You know, we have to believe in ourselves, and you have to follow your passions. And
there's a lot of limiting beliefs that we've had, that we've been taught, and we say, I can't do, oh, that's for him. He can write a book. If you look at me, like, I know nothing about writing. 2 years ago, I knew nothing about it. Now it's going to be in bookstores. It's just like you said, I moved. I did it. I kept going, and you have to just do it. You have to get rid of the limiting beliefs. You know, so many people have a book inside of them, and they're afraid to write it, because what if nobody reads it? But what if, they're not going to read it if you don't write it. So you got to just make that move.
Exactly. So your freelance business was you and your wife then actually did wedding photography, which was kind of like the nemesis, you know, as a professional photography, nobody wanted to do weddings. Yeah. And as if you've ever had a wedding and you've had to pay for one and plan for one, you know that the photographer and flowers and there's certain parts are extremely expensive and it's very lucrative. So it actually was a wonderful vehicle for you to set out on your own and to create this business dynamics that worked out great.
Yeah, it was something where, you know, like you said, like we were journalists. We were too good for that. That's really the way the whole industry looked at it. And then what happened was we booked our first wedding, and it wasn't very much money. Then we booked three or four more. And all of a sudden, I think we booked a wedding that was around $3,000. And I remember walking into the bathroom with the newspaper. I'll never forget this. And I was like, $3,000. I'm like, I work here. Yeah, we have to do work afterwards, but it's essentially a day that you have to be there. And I was like, if we do 20 weddings at $60,000, Elizabeth and I together make $62,000, and we have to come into work 240 days.
Right.
And I remember almost passing out. I was so like, and I remember going to the calculator, like, is that right? Like, there has to be something wrong with those numbers. And I was like, no, that was the moment that I was like, this is insane what I'm doing. We have a kid on the way. Like, I could actually be with them and raise them and not be frustrated. I still remember that, like, the eye opening. That's what I try to teach other people. Like, you have like my dad said to me, you have a skill, but you're not using it correctly. I think so many people have that, and they settle for security.
Right, exactly. And then later in your book, you actually met with, I think it was Kyle, was it?
Yes, Kyle Schultz.
And you have an expertise of photographing sports.
Yeah.
And so why don't you tell everyone how you started to blend the both of those into a course?
Yeah, this is something that it's so funny you bring up, because like it's something I never would have thought of, right? Because I was so, like many of us, so trained on this is what I do and this is how I make money. I'm a photographer, so I use these cameras to take pictures at events and they pay me money and then it's over. And I never thought about, we taught a little bit, we did a little bit of one-on-one coaching, but we didn't like it. I met this guy, Kyle, who runs a thing called Schultz Photo School. And it's an online school teaching parents how to take better pictures of their kids. I remember being pretty jealous when I heard about it, because I was like, I could have done that. But and he was doing very well. But we met in a mastermind retreat, and he gave his presentation of what his business was about. And then I gave my presentation about my career. And everybody's so enthralled with the sports things. I kind of get over it. You know, you do it enough. They're just some people. But he looked at me, and I looked at him, and I said to him, I said, I have an idea. And he said, yes. And I said,
like a good blending, yes.
Yeah. But I said, you don't even know what I'm going to say. And he said, go ahead, ask me. And I said, I should do a sports photography course for your school. Because he's not a sports photographer, but I know there's a million parents out there that want to take better sports pictures of their kids, and they want to take it from somebody who knows.
Absolutely.
Never thought that was a viable option. So we go ahead, we immediately decide to do it. 2 months later, we're writing the course. 2 months after that, we're recording the course. We were in PNC Park in the dugout here in Pittsburgh recording it. And we opened up the course. Now, he had an email list. I didn't have anything. I had the content from what I did for a living. And so it opens up, and he gives me an email the night it ended. And he said, this many sales, we made $32,700 the first day.
That's great. And I totally can relate to that. I have two swimmers. I had a swimmer, and then my other son was a gymnast and an Olympic level diver. And a diver, you off the platform, the highest diving board, the cement block, you have 3.2 seconds to capture 3.5 twists, 2.5 somersaults. I mean, you're talking about speed
and bad light
and light and everything else. And oh my goodness. So I can totally resonate with wanting to learn how to take good photographs, which I did. But, you know, having a course would be a really great way. So I think that's a great business model that I could definitely see, you know, people using. And now with iPhones, with iPhones, you know, everyone is taking pictures of everything.
Oh, yeah. The craziest part about it was, though, it's like, I never saw that. I didn't think Cindy would be interested in this. I never thought about that. So, but with the same talent, the same skill, the same mindset, we made as much in a day as I used to do for a year.
I know.
And then you go, well, what else? What are we all leaving out there? What are each of us? Because this goes beyond me at this point. Like, I'm good. We're good. What? And so that's why I teach, because it's like, we have so many, like, I try to say this, if you can make $80,000 at a job or $120,000 at a job, but they think I can't start a business, you have a skill that is marketable. You've just gave it to somebody else. It doesn't have to be the same exact job, but you can take those skills you have and you can use that in different areas of the world to earn income on your own. I think we undersell ourselves a lot. And I think if we got rid of those limiting beliefs, we would be in a better spot.
And, you know, to be honest too, Vincent, I think that unfortunately, and this is more the inner self speaking here, my book and my aspect, is that we're always searching for more. We're so dissatisfied with what the world has and what we've created or lack of created, that we're never content. You know, we're always wanting that extra $30,000 or the extra $50,000. And you know, money does not buy us happiness.
No.
What I liked about your book is it was not just about financial freedom. It's having the freedom to have time to spend with my family, having the freedom to travel, to explore new opportunities, not just only around the business and being so crazy and stressed about, I got to produce, that I become so stressful. I'm not enjoying my life. So happiness, freedom is really huge. And you bring this up in the book. And I think that we each have to find that balance point in what we're doing.
I totally agree. And it starts out about money, right? A lot of the book, but it really shifts because I've met a lot of miserable, wealthy people.
Yeah.
I think it was David Geffen said, show me somebody who says that money buys happiness and I'll show you someone who's never had money.
Yeah.
But there's nothing wrong with it. It can relieve a lot of problems, but I think a lot of people get that, like you said, that extra money. If you're making 75 and you need 50 more, it's a bigger problem than money.
Right. And another quote that you have in the book is, why do I look so good but feel so bad?
Yeah.
So, you know, the bottom line number does not mean you're going to feel great, you know, if that's not really bringing you the happiness. So it's so important to really connect. And, you know, you connected with, first, there was a need. You needed financial security for your family. And that's pretty much for everybody. We need to be able to pay for the house and the lights and the food and clothing and the heat.
Yeah.
And so that's a staple. And for some people, that in itself is very hard to ascertain.
Yeah.
And so what can we do? And your book shows us lots of different ways. There's a seven, I know on page 206 towards the end of the book, there's a 7-step guide for inspiration that you give. Do you recall what those are? Can you share them with us?
You're putting me on the spot.
I can help you out. I have them here. So that, there you go.
It's been a while. One of them is the Acres of Diamonds. I know, because it is like, I think so many, and that story, I love that story. And it's in the book. It's about basically, I don't have to recite it, but basically all of us have this acre of diamonds that we don't even know we're sitting on. All of us have a skill that is marketable in some other way. And so much of it is like the money comes into factor. And this is one of those seven things. It's like when you get control of your money, when you get rid of your debt, you then free up your time. And when you free up your time, the most amazing thing that happens is you free up your mental space. And then when you have that mental space and you have that time, you can go for a 3-hour walk and come up with an idea that's going to make you more money in a day that makes you in a year.
But creativity's born. Yeah.
Exactly. But when I was stressed and I was worried about money and I was always doing jobs just for the money, I had no time to even think about that stuff.
Right.
So it's not about becoming wealthy. I'm tired of so many businesses, $1 billion. I don't care about $1 billion. We want it to be financially free. And we wanted time freedom and mental freedom. But the crazy thing that comes from that is that stuff happens. once you do that stuff, but you don't do it with stress. And it happens doing the fun things that you want to do. It's just
and it comes so much more naturally, and it's the universe, I call the universal flow, is supporting you because you're aligned with using your gifts. Your gift was capturing, you know, moments in time, you know, for film. And you used it in many different ways, and that was a gift, how you saw the world through the lens. The second one, I'll help you out, not to put you on the spot, was using your developed talents to help someone who needs it. So finding that marketplace or the tribe that needs what you have.
I think that's a huge one, and I think it's missed a lot because I don't know if you were ever there, but I was there where I was broken desperate. And when I was broken desperate, the last person I was thinking about was anybody but me. I was always worried about what I needed. And that smells. That's desperate. So you don't help anybody when you're like that. But when you are using what you can do to help other people, that's the law of reciprocity. It comes back to you. So when you go out of your way, and that's why I had the hour of giving. That came within the book because I started the day thinking about myself and what I needed. And then when I realized it's not about me, and it's never going to be about me, it's about helping other people, I spend the first hour, now 2 hours a day, doing stuff for other people, giving comments, reviews, all those type of things to make uplift other people so that when I get onto my work, I have now boosted the life of other people before I even started. That alone, I'll give you an example. I just sent out random messages, right, on Facebook out of nowhere, just seeing how people are doing. One woman, Jennifer, who we did corporate work for, was a very lucrative client. She left that job to go to a full-time university job. Now, if I'm thinking like a business person, she's out of my life, if it's except for a friendship, because she can't help me. But I messaged to see how her job was. She goes, it's so funny you messaged me because I hate my job and I'm quitting. And I'm starting my own business and I need somebody to take pictures for me. I need you to do it. Hired us, very lucrative job. Never would have happened. But if you multiply that, of go out of your way to help other people, leave reviews, like for Cindy's book, leave a review for it. It matters. It helps because that boosts your thing. And then you will remember that person. And then when they need something, you are going to almost feel guilty not doing it for them.
Well, there's an energetic exchange, is a connection, in that I believe people are in our lives for reasons, and that when you open up to that, not from what can they do, but what can I do for them, how can this interaction be beneficial to both, and you're meeting different needs, then that's where the universe are bringing people together, and we become blinded. You know, the horse that runs the race has those blinders on the side, so they can't see the side, they only can see the, you know, in front of them, that, you know, there is so much around us and we are so blinded by all that is, that we're just so focused on our own path that we are often going down the path with only the obstacles and not seeing the wonderful, luxurious life that is existing around us as we are living it.
Well, it's funny because David Hancock, you know, our publisher, he said to me, and it was a really bold statement, but he's like, and it wasn't personal. He's like, nobody cares about your book. And I'm like, ugh. You know what? But it's true. It's like you have to write something that helps other people, that helps them so much that they want to buy it and endorse it and review it. It's not because you wrote a book. Everybody's writing a book. But what is it about your book that's going to make other people feel something? So it's again, it's beyond yourself.
Right.
I never would have, even 5 years ago, I wouldn't have gotten this message.
Yeah. Okay, let's move on to number three. The third one is take the need and create the career you desire.
Yeah. Because then all of a sudden you're helping these people. You see what they're struggling with and how you can help them.
So now, but it's also you creating what you desire. What's the career? What's your passion? And again, this is that contemplative step that we need to take. What is the passion? What is our gift that we are blinded to? What can we use and how can we turn that into something that's meaningful?
Exactly. And I think a lot of us in the freelance world, we're afraid to charge because we think we're doing something wrong. But like you said before, a win-win. If I can provide a product that brings you something way above the value of what I'm charging for it. Now, this is a win-win because if I'm doing it for free, I can't continue to do that because I've got to feed my kids. So if I can do something that brings back, if you are more than willing to spend $150 for a course, right, for instance, and you're going to get priceless pictures of your kids, well, you're going to be happy you bought it and I'm going to be happy I made it. That's the way in a perfect world that's going to work. It's not going to be like you spend $150 on a course, you go, that was terrible. Like, you're never going to come back to me or recommend it. So you've got to do both of those things. You've got to create the thing that you want to do, because if you enjoy doing it, you are going to put your heart and soul into it. as opposed to a job you don't like, and that it helps other people.
Right. And then number four is use your income from the career or your passion to wipe out your debt and become financially free. And I think that's just, again, is working to live within your means and not just all this money coming in. I'm just going to go farther in debt and try to get bigger, faster. Bigger doesn't necessarily mean better. And I think that's really important.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And you can even do the financial thing earlier, but that's a good step to go by.
And then the fifth one is that use that financial freedom to create time freedom and emotional freedom and any other words you want to put in there. But I think that's really so important to really create success in your life in all aspects of your life.
Exactly, because I think it comes back to it's beyond business and money. It's like, you know, we're taking a 3-month road trip with our family starting the day that the book launches. We're going out west. You can't buy that, you know, and it's the type of thing where we're going to create memories together. That's what we want out of life. Because I think I would have thought at some point, no, more money would have done that. And it's not. It's not the money. It's like, okay, even when that course launched, it wasn't about that we're getting that money. It was kind of like, wow, we did something. All the stuff that we're teaching about, like, wow, that actually works if you do it this way. So it wasn't the check that came in. It's nice, but once you get, what's the saying? Like, once you get beyond $75,000, it doesn't really matter in terms of happiness. I'm not sure if that's, you know, completely accurate, but I think it's the type of thing where it's like, that's why you see a lot of people that have a lot of money, but they're giving up all their time and their freedom and they're dissatisfied and they go, what's next? Because I have the money.
Yeah. But you know, I tell you, sometimes I do things for no fee at all. And to me, I realize the impact I'm having. I speak all the time for free. And knowing that I've impacted people and hearing from them after, that's my reward. So, you know, I think we need to realize, you know, we should be paid, and I love being paid too, but there are times that even our counsel or our guidance or our assistance just at a Dunkin' Donuts or a library or something, those are beneficial exchanges between people that really bring value. And, you know, we get so tied down on the money aspect that we have to remember there is a deeper meaning to our life than just what is coming in a paycheck.
And that's beautiful, because you developed an area of your life that you can go and speak and you are completely happy with it. And I joke around, and it sounds worse than it is, but I say I have two prices. I have free and expenses. Free is when I want to do it, I just want to do it. So if somebody wants me to speak, or if somebody needs help on a coaching call and I just want to give them a call, that's on me to do. Expensive is when you want me to do something. If you are asking me to do something for your benefit, that's where we get paid what we're worth. And that's been our way with our photography. But if we're doing a charity or somebody's struggling, I want to do it. It's not about the money. But if you're coming to me on your terms of what you need me at this time, at this day, this is our rate. So it's worked out so well having that mindset. Like, we can do it our way if we want to, but if you want it your way, this is the way we have to do it.
Right. And one of the other ones is use your time freedom to build stronger family, deeper relationships. And I love that, because for you, it really became very pertinent. It always was. Your family was always the base level of why you were working so hard to create security and this freedom that you were looking for, because you wanted to have this deeper relationship and time with your family. Yeah. And I think that's so important to always remember that, you know, like anything, like putting time and effort into your business, you have to put time and effort into your family if you want that to grow and to thrive.
Well, and you probably read it. I had a really eye-opening photo shoot, and I was at this sprawling mansion. And I went there and I'm thinking, we have a baby on the way. It was our third kid. And I'm thinking, at that point, I still hadn't gotten this yet. And I remember saying to him, like, what do I do to do what you did? And he stopped and he looked at me, because why do you want this? And I was like, well, and I didn't really know what to say, because if I were you, he asked me about my kids and my family. He goes, if I were you, I wouldn't be looking for this. He goes, this is what I looked for, and I lost my family. And he goes, and I have a beautiful house that's fully furnished and it's empty and it's lonely. And he goes, I'm eating the same food as you are. Say, I wouldn't go for this. I would do what you're doing now, focus on your family, but this is not your focus. And I stopped and I was like, that was more important than anything I ever learned in school right there, because he had actually done it, and he's what people give up 40 years of their career for.
Right.
And then they get there and realize this was not it. And
that's so I love your book, because it really covers so much, your pain, your struggle, and how you fought to get out. It wasn't a magical star or a miracle that just poof, the light switch turned on and everything changed. It was years. Yeah. And I think it's important for people to realize it takes time, commitment, perseverance, and to really achieve these things, but they are achievable. And believing in oneself is really the initial crux of you desiring something and following through on that. So many, many wonderful, valuable tools and things to interrelate within your own life and your passion and what you want to do.
Well, thank you so much. I really appreciate that. I appreciate your reading. That means a lot.
Yeah, great. So what are you doing right now? Anything else? I know you're doing some side work on photography and sports again, which is your passion still. That's wonderful. And of course, now you have your book. Are you doing other courses or what?
It's such a hard question for me because honestly, like when people go, what do? I laugh and I go, it depends on what day and what hour. Because like Sunday I was shooting the Steelers Patriots game. I have, we have weddings. I did a corporate shoot. I run two mastermind groups for freelancers, business coaching. I do one-on-one coaching. We have the book and all the promotion that goes with that. We've got the online course. I'm opening up a membership site next year for Freelance Freedom called the Freelance Tribe. So it's something between the book and the masterminds. So it's like, okay, is it 10 o'clock on Wednesday or is it 1 o'clock on Sunday? That's depends on what day it is and what time it is. It depends on what I'm doing.
All right. So maybe the question is, if you want to learn more about Vincent, where's the website they should go to check out you?
The Freelance Tribe is where it's all at. That's our website.
The Freelance Tribe, TRIBE.com. And you'll be able to connect with him, send an email to him. And find out more of what he's offering. So this is wonderful. And again, do you have a copy of your book with you?
I don't. I should have.
Oh, well, that's okay. You can see it on his website. Yeah. And Freelance to Freedom is available worldwide. You can buy it online, Amazon, Barnes & Noble, all the online stores, as well as the brick and mortars. And if they don't have it, all you have to do is ask them to order it, and they will be happy to do that. So we have a wonderful publisher, Morgan James, which we love dearly. And we're happy to know that our books are around and available worldwide. So I hope you all take advantage of Vincent's book. Again, Freelance to Freedom. Is there any parting words you want to say before we sign off?
I just want to thank you for having me on. This has been a pleasure and just a joy to have this conversation. I'm so glad we finally got to talk.
Great. Thank you for being here. And I love bringing all these different authors here. Their books are rich with information and tools and things that people can use in their life and really transform. And we're all looking and searching for different resources. So these are all wonderful. And I'm happy to do this as well. So thank you, listeners, for being here. Once again, we have a fabulous author, and his book is, again, Vincent Puglisi. I'm not probably saying that just right, and his name is Freelance to Freedom. So check it out. Order your book, and it's a great holiday gift or a great way to start the new year. So thanks again, and have a wonderful evening.
Thank you.